Dr. Dodone, I've got to say thank you so much for joining us today. I'm so interested in learning about your background and where you started working with the Deanna protocol and how this story really came out of your own story, really. I mean, it's your own daughter is Deanna, but how you've transitioned from a career of orthopedic surgery into what you thought was going to be a nice retirement, and then turned into coming out of retirement because you became this researcher and now you've become this incredible expert in neurodegenerative diseases. And again, thank you for being here, but I can give a little bit about your background, but I want you to tell me your background.
I retired. I was chief of orthopedics at University Community Hospital, which is now Florida Hospital in the Advent System. I retired in 1997. My wife and I traveled extensively for 10 years. In 2007, my daughter Deanna complained of stumbling every time she walked. And she noticed that she saw me coming down a flight of stairs. And she said, "Dad, you came down those stairs. You didn't even look at the stairs." And I said, "Deanna, you don't look at the stairs." She didn't realize that she had to look at the stairs so that she wouldn't lose her balance. I checked her reflexes and they were abnormal. She was an attorney at the time and had just made partner in a local law firm. And one of the things that would happen that really scared me was if she would stumble, she would fall, but she lost the reflex ability to put her hands out to block the fall. So she would hit her head.
So all of this was prior, we're here talking about Deanna, all of this is prior to Deanna's diagnosis of ALS.
Yes.
So these are just the early signs of the early symptomatic observations that were taking place, but no one knew what it was at the time.
Exactly. So we started to bring her around to physicians, and a friend of mine, a neurologist in Tampa, did an EMG study on her. And the test, which basically shows action potentials in muscles, was very indicative of ALS. And he didn't really want to make that diagnosis, and so we went to Johns Hopkins. Yes, she has ALS. We went to the Mayo Clinic. Yes, she has ALS. And they gave her 2 to 5 years to live. Go home, get your affairs in order. And
So I have to interrupt you and ask this question. So here you are, an established physician who've retired from being the head of orthopedics at the hospital. You've worked with all these famous athletes. You've worked with all of these things. And now here you are as a father hearing a diagnosis of your own daughter. I mean, you've got these superpowers in the medical field with all these other people in the world, and now you've got a diagnosis of your daughter, which is something that you had no experience in. I have to imagine that just felt like such a helpless feeling, because here you are, this master of medicine, and now it hits home.
Yeah, well, it was. It was daunting. And it was just something that it was almost impossible for me to accept. I had one experience with ALS, and it happened to be just an observational experience where I saw a woman taken out of a wheelchair and put into a chair that extended out from the car, and just watched her total inability to move, and then the chair picked her up and went in the car. And I said to myself, can you imagine? You still have a brain, you can still think, but your body doesn't function. You can't hold anything, you can't walk, you can't even sit up straight.
being flashbacks of this moment when you hear that your daughter now has ALS.
Absolutely.
You're thinking back to this woman you saw completely debilitated in a van one day.
And I'm saying, is this going to be my daughter? And Deanna and I discussed it. And she says, Dad, I don't want to die. And I said, I don't want you to die. I said, look, if you'll be the test case, I'll do everything I can to research neurodegenerative diseases and see if I can find something that would work in helping you. She said, fine. So this was the covenant. And indeed, almost for 2 years, I injected her with substances. She took oral substances, intravenous substances, and to see if there was anything that might help her. During this period of time, her disease was progressing. I think it was about 2011 when I came across this product, alpha-ketoglutaric acid, which when I gave it to her, she said, Dad, I can carry a glass of water without spilling it now. And patients who have ALS have incessant muscle symptoms, twitching, fasciculations, so they're very uncomfortable. And the AKG suppressed those symptoms. She also had severe muscle cramps. And I spoke to her doctor at Johns Hopkins, and he said, you can use gabapentin. I researched gabapentin. I saw it was GABA aminobutyric acid, which is the primary inhibitory neurotransmitter. And we put her on that. It was not supposed to be able to pass the blood-brain barrier, but she started taking it. She no longer had the cramps.
I want to add, this is 4 years later.
This yes.
is 2007 as a diagnosis, and you started work immediately, which is probably one of the most amazing parts I hear of the story, because being familiar with the story, she received the diagnosis, and you didn't wait a year. You didn't wait 2 years. You didn't, you jumped into action, like a heroic father would. But you jumped into action to start doing this. But it wasn't for 4 years that you really came across what started working. So 2 to 5 year diagnosis, that's her, you said you used the words, go home and get your affairs in order.
Yes.
She has 2 to 5 years to live. You started doing all of these things, desperately searching for something that would have an impact. And I would argue and say something was having an impact because she stayed alive all the way through 2011 when you came across some of these things. So her condition, she continued to degenerate. She continued to have cellular death. She continued to, become more symptomatic and more symptomatic as time played out. But 4 years, she was a patient zero to your research. That time had to seem like an eternity.
Well, it did. And once we started the Deanna protocol, which was the combination of AKG and GABA, and let me just say, that's the core Deanna protocol. But alpha-ketoglutaric acid is it's a biacid. Bipolar acid, it's very strong. And we look for something to neutralize it. And arginine is a bipolar base. And so arginine neutralized it. Plus, there was an added benefit to arginine, which was basically it increased energy production in the mitochondria. It also lowered blood sugar and caused vasodilation, which increased blood supply. So the Deanna protocol was developed AAKG and GABA. And we started her on that. And I said, this is working for my daughter. Her cognition was improved. Her muscle symptoms were suppressed. and the speed with which the disease was progressing was slowed down. And so that was 2011. We had a lot of patients who reported that it helped them also. They stated, you know, I can swallow, I couldn't swallow before. And I don't have the muscle symptoms. Some might say, well, it didn't really help the muscle symptoms. And I would tell them, okay, stop taking it for a few weeks and let me know how you do.
So I want to add in there, you used the word, we had a lot of patients, but you weren't treating anybody.
No.
But my understanding is that because people knew Deanna and they knew her situation, and you'd been networking in this ALS community so deeply, that people saw what was happening with her and they started asking you questions, and what is she doing and what therapeutics are you using on her, and you started sharing this formula with people. So you weren't treating patients per se, but you were actually having other people experiment with it and collecting anecdotal
exactly,
support.
Exactly. I was not treating patients. In fact, the desire to get this word out, my family basically started a 501c3 not-for-profit corporation, winningthefight.org. The acronym is WFND, Winning the Fight Against Neurodegenerative Diseases. And this was to go online and have a site that we could direct people to and tell them the story about Deanna. And what happened was, and I tried to promote this to neurologists, and they said, well, this is just anecdotal evidence and we can't accept it. So then we decided to fund a research project at the University of South Florida. And we funded that project on ALS mice. That is, mice that were engineered mutationally to have ALS. And what we found was, and nothing, no other product had ever touched these mice or helped them. It slowed the disease progression, improved their muscle function, and improved their energy production, because they did metabolomic studies on the mice, which basically show what are the products, the catabolic products, breakdown products of energy production. And the mice that were on the DP, it was increased. Well, the people in academia, the neurologists said to me, you can't transfer my studies to humans.